Hello and welcome back to the Student StarCraft AI Tournament. I'm your host Shonko this week from Making Computer Do Things, and our first game is a ZvZ between Hopark and Zerzerzer. Hopark sounds like based on the description, a bot from one of the Asian universities, which we had a few pop up recently on SSCIT, and I welcome that fact. From the outset, it seems it's just a 5 pool bot. It is quite possible, 4 or 5 pool, and yeah, indeed it is. It's just make Zerlings go and stream across the map. So we have a lot of low ranking 5 pool bots or 4 pool bots in the ladder, and if you're gonna start out writing a bot, I suggest you do not do that, you try to something else. It is a good way to test if your bot is working, and it's a simple strategy to implement, but other than that, yeah, it's just not that interesting, and many bots have counter built in against Warpool, because I think it's the number one simple strategy that you can use. And Zerzerzer is just defending, taking up to lair, so this will probably end when Zerzerzer just gets out a few Myrtalisks, and well, Hopark has literally no air defense, only a pool and only streaming Zerling, so I think we all know how it will end. Let's just speed this up. That's surely a spire. Yes, that is a spire. So that means that the first few Mutalisks will just mop up Hopark space. So I don't know if the author is watching this broadcast. I'm hoping he is. And yeah, nice attempt, but this time it just proved not enough. What is happening here? Oh, that's a spire actually. Interesting. I didn't even notice the lair here. So apparently Hopark can switch up. That's good. That is a very good sign, but this is over. No workers, no money for a worker, and just too many Mutalisks. Okay, nice attempt, but Zerzerzer is victorious. Let's jump into the next game. The next game is IceLab versus MacRave Zerg. IceLab is a long time favorite, well, a long time winner, I should say, not updated like in this century, but it's still a formidable opponent and one of the rare bots that actually utilizes high ground. And dear bot authors, utilize your high ground, it's real estate, you should utilize your high ground. It is. I don't know how to plead with you, it's just no reasoning with you. High ground is free advantage, and you need a high ground. High ground is good. Okay, with that rant over, it seems that IceLab is going for the standard, how should I characterize it? Probably a few infantry, then attacking up to factory very quickly. I don't know even if IceLab has multiple builds even. Oh, no, that's an expansion. I expected a factory, to be honest. But no. The gas is not even done yet, so I misread the situation and didn't pay that close of attention. And MacRave Zerg is expanding as well, not taking the second gas just yet. Well, and taking up to lair, so probably the next unit we will see is a Mutalisk. And nice bunker defense from IceLab. I don't know if that's based on scouting, I think it is. Actually, MacRave does not have that many units, so 2 Zerglings in total, but maybe IceLab is. Well, it's very possible that this bunker just plopped down here, because why not? It's just a surefire defense. I mean, at this stage you can't really go that wrong with a bunker. I mean, you certainly lose some resources, and especially with filling the bunkers, but it's a safe bet, I should say. So it's like it's very rare that you lose a game because you built a bunker in your natural. That's what I'm saying. But it must have happened. In the meantime, engineering bay, and that's probably a factory. No, that's an academy actually. Okay, we have a factory here already. I just don't see a machine shop, to be honest. I expected IceLab to go for tanks, but no, that was wrong of me. And the first few Mutalisks are out, and nicely turreting up. Oh, this is four turrets and the bunker, although this corner is not protected. So these, well, depending on Macrave's actual Mutalisk micro, this can do a lot of damage, but S-Lab is making a decent job of protecting, but I think that's too many turrets in one place, and it's not in a center place. I mean, four turrets in protecting the mineral line, that I can accept, I can sleep sound when I see that, but this is just Russell's my Jimmy's a little bit. And McReeve is upping the Mutalisk count, 11 Mutalisks now, and 11 Mutalisks can one-shot many things, and I think, no, not turrets, but I think they are not far from doing that. I think 200 has turret have or something like that. Oh, and the Valkyrie is out. Nice counter from Ice Lab, but a Valkyrie by itself is not the best. It's always, although it is doing a decent job, nice split from McRae. So McRae is realizing that, oh no, I am against the Valkyrie, maybe I should not give the Valkyrie a free area of effect damage, and that's exactly what's happening. And even though the mutants do get damage, they don't suffer as much. And oh, that's, I don't know if how intentional is this. It seems to me that McRae is splitting the Mutalisk so to not suffer from AoE damage. But McRae is not engaging the Valkyrie, so nice attempt, but you should maybe attack. And a lot of Mutalisk get lost, so oh no, that was just painful to see. And the sad thing is that McRae has had Pestens, had more than enough Mutalisk to engage. But not anymore. Those good times are over now. And Ice Lab is just out on the map. Goliaths, Marines, and Valkyries. Ice Lab is just making good progress here. McRae is still making Mutalisk. Oh, a lot of creeps. That's good, I think. A lot of creeps here. Maybe a little bit going overboard with the creeps. But McRae can afford it, so I don't know. McRae desperately needs some more gas, and yeah, in order to make a decent amount of Mutalisk, you need 3 gas as a Zerg. And McRae just barely has that. By barely I mean this expansion is fairly recent, and it is not discovered by Ice Lab, but McRae is losing Mutalisk left and right. You can't sustain it. We have 4 Valkyries and they are basically undamaged. I think one of them has some damage, yeah, but that's it. Yeah, the front one has little damage. 5 Valkyries now, and there is the third base for McRae, and the creeps are not morphed, and the invading force is not discovered. I think as soon as this Goliath enters sight range, yes, exactly, the Sunkens will morph, but I think that's too late. That's too late. McRae should have had some scouting out. I think these Sunkens will get popped. Oh no, they won't. They just finish in time, so I was wrong about that. And 6 Sunkens is quite good, especially because Goliaths are not that good against ground units. They can be surprisingly good. Oh, nice burrow from McRae, that I really like. Just going into the ground. And this is something that not many Zerg players utilize, actually. Burrow is a good skill. But we have a drop coming in from Ice Lab, and McRae has nothing to stop it. A few Mutalisks, but dropships are quite tanky. Dropships have 1 armor. And do we have armor upgrades for... no, we don't. For the dropship, but yeah, dropping a few Goliaths, and if you have as many Goliaths as the enemy has Mutalisks, then probably you will win. But no reinforcements arrive. We have 6-7 Mutalisks here. Still, it's close. I feel maybe you should have focused on killing the drones, because these units are dead. These units are on borrowed time anyway. But a little bit of damage is done, but killing Mutalisks is something that you can do anywhere on the map with a little bit of exaggeration. Interesting forward hatchery here. Maybe it's just a meat shield from McRae, and I think McRae could swing this, but not this way. Like, McRae is just So adamant on making Mutalisk's hand. Mutalisk, don't beat Valkyries. That is the takeaway here. Mutalisks do not beat Valkyries, especially bunched up and without any support. I think a Hydra switch maybe could save Mekrev here, but I think Mekrev is still making Mutalisks. Let's say, production tab. Mekrev is still making Mutalisks. And why Goliaths are not the best sunken busting units, they can do it. They eventually can do it, and it's just the economy is... Oh, the two players have almost the same amount of resources. Oh no, actually, Icelab just dropped down, but comparable amount of resources in orders of magnitude, thank you very much. But the supply looks very bad for Mekrev. It's still a 3 bases versus 3 bases. Why is it so hard to phrase that correctly? So it is 3 mining base. Oh no, actually that is 1, 2, 3, 4 for Ice Lab and the 5th flopping now. So it's a 4 versus 3. I was wrong yet again. I'm always getting these things wrong because counting is hard. And yeah, sunker busting will happen. I don't know, but let's see how much upgrades we have. We have plus one weapons, and that's it. I feel some armor on the Goliaths would go a long way here against the Sunken Sand, especially against the Mutalisks. But we don't see the develop, we only see the plus two weapons, which is still good, but at this point Ice Lab can afford an armory, I think, and another one just for upgrades, and especially in the mid to late game when cost of an upgrade is not significant. Oh, nice Vulture drop from Ice Lab. So in the late game when you have money for upgrades, even you can even spare the gas now, it's just no reason not to do them. It's even the just plop down an armory or three. I think upgrades are force multipliers, and if you have like 10 units you should need an upgrade because it's just worth it. And yeah, the vultures completely depopulate this base in regard of drones, de-drone them, I guess, that's a word. And after de-droning the main, Ice Lab is a little bit reluctant to engage, but I think Mekrev's economy is just in shambles. Having 36 versus 80 workers, yeah, you're not gonna recover from that. And Ice Lab is mining on the new base undisturbed, although this third is still happily mining away. So Ice Lab is focused on the enemy's main. That might not be the best strategy here. I think busting workers everywhere could bring a shorter game to you. You could finish your opponent quicker that way. And Mekrev is still making just Mutalisks. Production, yeah, Mutalisks. And then the Valkyries come and the Mutalisks just get deleted. And yeah, goodbye Mutalisks. It's just not fun for the Zerg player. Okay, let me speed this up. I think this match is Ice Lab's to lose at this point, and Ice Lab is just gathering some units, trying to bust in, not always succeeding. Now it does. Oh, and we have some more tanks in the mix. Tanks were not really used, and interestingly, Ice Lab is not sieging them up, which can be a good choice. Actually, if you don't siege your tanks, their DPS is higher. So if you just busting down buildings and you have no resistance, then you should maybe not siege up your tanks. And you have a lot of use cases for not sieging up. Basically, if you can't outrange your opponent, or if you're not being fired upon. So if you're not threatened yourself as a tank, then you should not siege up, or something like that. And nice game from Ice Lab. The old dog still has a lot of bite. This time it's a TVZ yet again on Heartbreak Ridge. I actually didn't forget the map's name. It's KSOBot versus Brian Weber. Brian Weber, Dr. Brian Weber, actually is an AI researcher and does AI researchy things where he teaches people to how to program bots. So that's a thing you know now. And KSOBot is actually a student bot from the University of Bratislava, and Is it University of Bratislava or some university in Bratislava, which I don't know the name of, but I am pretty sure of Bratislava. So, with that being said, let's see what Kieselbot will do. Interesting placement, but oh, this is gonna be a... I would have placed the wall a little bit out, but I don't think this is tight. Yeah, I think this is not a link tight wall. But it's an attempt from Kieselbot to wall up supply and barracks. And let's see what Prime Weber is doing. Just getting out a few zerglings. It is on 9 pool. It was on over pool maybe. I didn't catch that, but we have a Overlord just floating about, so it could have been either a 9 pool or an over pool, one of those. The point is that first of all the game sound is a little bit too much. Oh yeah, and that is not a good placement for, I don't know. Maybe the barracks placement is okay, but you need a bunker desperately. And the marines pop out and they are not protected. So what you're doing right now is a nice repair attempt from Kieselbot. I really like that it is keeping the buildings alive. But what's your long-term plan here? It's like your mining, a lot of mining time is lost. Do we have a vulture in production? No, we don't. Probably we don't have money for it. So zerglings have a little bit high DPS, so I'm not sure you can sustain this like resource wise. You really need a bunker or a vulture, but one of those ASAP. And Kieselbot is actually making a starport. I guess a wraith can kill a lot of zerglings unopposed, but I think you can just outproduce a wraith's DPS. It's like wraith is good for harassing, but at the later stages you just outproduce them. You can make units faster than a wraith can kill them. Not air units, of course, but ground units, definitely. And I think the zerglings will just break here. It's like too many DPS, too much DPS. And interestingly, not all the zerglings are engaging in a good fashion. They don't, like they try to attack the same building over and over again. Now we have one wraith, but yeah, as you can see, a wraith is not a high DPS, not a high ground DPS unit, I should say. And also, these lings could have just run by and finished this game already. But we have a vulture. The vulture is actually very good against the lings, and it is stealing the herd. The zerglings are not trading very good, because they could have attacked all the buildings at the same time, but instead they were trying to bust this one supply depot in the choke point. They could have run by, so I don't know what it's about. Oh, two macro hatches. The Ling strategy is really on point. It's like Brian Weber is committed to Ling strategy. Interestingly enough, we don't have Ling speed. No link speed and no actual attack upgrade. So yeah, it's a little bit weird this way. But yet again, this is kind of a student bot, I guess. So let's not dwell on that. Let's just focus on the actual performance. And it is a 3 hatch, 11 workers and all the links ever. And Kieselbot is stabilizing, having double the workers that Brian Weber has, and generally just building up the forces. And with this tank and vulture count, and vultures are really important in this matchup, because they bust a lot of zerglings. Vultures are very good against zerglings, especially if you micro them properly. And as a bot, you can kite zerglings indefinitely. If you do it well. And we have, how many wraiths do we have? Like five, yes. We have five wraiths. Five wraiths do make a dent in the ever flowing zergling tide, but mostly the vultures and the tanks who are on point. And eventually Kieselbot should just move out, and this is getting into a stalemate. Kieselbot taking its sweet time building up the forces, nice worker transfer, and that's basically it. And now the move out is, that's not the way, the other way around. Yeah, so they're moving out, but not to the right direction. But I think, yeah, this is a tight block for tanks or something like that. So okay, so I had a tank tight wall, which is not something you want to have when you're facing a Zerg. And I think Kesu can't move out until this supply is here. And probably Kesu will not attack its own buildings. Some bots realize that oh hey, I'm blocked, so I need to kill one of my own buildings. And humans do that as well, but that's just Starker for you. Will this burn down? No, this will not burn down because it's not in the red. So it is a weird block when Kesu can't move out. Oh, this is a turret, so one tank somehow get out. But I was gonna say, not even a theoretical chance now to get out. Until you mine this out, you can't go the back way either. But this restriction is not applying to wraiths, and I guess enough wraiths can eventually kill everything. And somehow another tank and watcher got out, but the majority of the army is just derping in the natural. And oh, mine, even using mines, and I think that was a good mine hit. I think Nepeta would have liked that. And yeah, that's it. Yeah, it's just moving with the wraiths. There is no opposition. There is no anti-air. Just moving in the wraiths and kill the buildings. Oh, that's just so hard to see. It's just so many Zerglings killed by these puny little lasers. These basically are like, you know, they are playing laser tag, but eventually they just do enough laser tagging that your units get killed. And nice tank line from Kesu. Somehow, yeah, this supply depot got burned down or attacked, and finally Kesu is out with the ground army and mopping up the last of the Zerg. Okay, this has been an interesting game and showcased many of the bot wackiness and strengths. I think this is a game where bot authors can learn from. And with that, I'm gonna call the GG here and let's jump into the next one. Up next, it's Nuibot versus Egbert. Nuibot is another student bot for a master's thesis from the China University of Mining and Technology, according to the description. And Egbert is a bot from Javier Sacedo of Spain. I don't know the exact university he went to, but yeah, it is a university bot as well. At least it started out that way, but Egbert has been on the ladder for quite a long time and performing quite well. So let's see another ZVT, and I promise that is the last ZVT we see. That's weird to say. ZVT we see today, and I often broke my promises as well. So Egbert seemingly a bit defensive with this SimCity arrangement and also a bunker protecting the mineral line, but against Zerg you can't be too cautious, and it seems that Nuibot is just a fighting bot. Oh no, why does it have to be this, right? This is the cruel fate of SSEIT casters watching 4 pool and 5 pool bots all the time. But at least we know probably how it will turn out, because I think this chasing the scouting SCV with all your army is just not a sound decision. Is that a second hatchery? Why is there a second hatchery now? That is just extremely weird. But okay. And only 4 workers from Nuibot. This is very weird. This hatchery, I don't think you need. I think you can support a 4 pool on 1. Oh, and we have an explosion of workers, so transitioning out from a 5 pool. Well, the general wisdom regarding that is that you don't transition out of a 5 pool. And a few fire bats from Egbert, and fire bats. I think the phrase is kill very dead comes to mind. They are very good against groups of Zerglings, and yeah, we can see that when they decide to engage, which is this engagement logic is a little bit wonky, but yeah, they just burn everything that is made of a Zergling. A little bit weird engagements here, but oh yes, I think these are favorable trades. Fire bats, are in a weird place because they are a very niche unit where they have a few uses when they are the absolute best, but generally they are clunky and not the best unit in the game. But this is exactly that use case versus Zerglings and drones. Firebats perform very well, and Firebats have one armor by default, so that makes them surprisingly tanky against these units. And yeah, this is just over, killing the enemy with only Firebats. And Firebats do absolutely pitiful damage to buildings, we must say that, but enough Firebats and enough pitiful damage makes a GG. That's our equation for today, and let's jump into the next game. So, no more ZVT, it's a PvP on a Tau Cross with Bereaver and Slater. Slater is a relatively newcomer into the bot world, and it is a Protoss bot, as you might have inferred from me saying it's a PvP match with your brilliant deduction skills. And the PvP world is kind of the hot stuff of the bot meta right now, because many of the top bots are Protoss. I think the Protoss has a certain lead in bot ratings right now. Do not make any assumptions based on that, because we don't have that many bots, just between 1 and 200 somewhere. I could look it up, but I'm too lazy to do that. So this is just not enough data to conclude the wisdom that Protoss is overpowered. Please don't do that. And it's 2-gate and Cybercore versus 2-gate and Pylon or something, or 3-gate. And Bereaver, as the name implies, uses reverse the great effect. Actually, Reaver and Shuttle Micro. Nice blocking of this entrance point. No expansion from either player yet. And no goons from Slater, which is interesting. I would expect goons by now, or at least researching the goon range. And Slater is a little bit behind on Zealot count, but it doesn't really matter, as there is something called a defender's advantage, and that can just balance it out. I think the players are pretty much toe-to-toe at this point. No Cybercore from Bereaver just yet, instead it is a Forge. Slater does not have a Forge, so they are going different ways, but Slater has a Dragoon, and I'm just checking on the main base of Bereaver every now and then. Okay, speeding up, some defensive cannons from Bereaver. I think Bereaver is just aiming for getting out the River Shuttle combo and just microing down the enemy. And indeed, the Cybercore, a Robotics Bay is being built somewhere. Where is the Robotics Bay actually? I can't see it, but apparently it is done. What did I miss? Or is it Slater? Oh, is it Slater rebuilding it? Okay. I just assumed that it is Bereaver because of the name. But no, actually, Slater seems to be just a tiny bit ahead to me. There is the expansion. Although Slater has less workers, one less workers, and that counts, even if just one. Oh, but that disappeared. Bereaver with the late expansion. Bereaver still does not have a Robotics or a Cybercore. Oh, he has a Cybercore, sorry, I didn't see that. So Robotics just finished. More units in the natural for Bereaver, but since neither player wants really to engage, this will be not the deciding battle, I feel. It's just a skirmish, throwing some goon energy balls back and forth. And now maybe they come to blows. No, they don't. They don't. They just retreat. And since Slater has more goons, Slater is trading more favorably in this engagement. The Zealots basically don't bother hitting each other for the most part. Just the frontline Zealots do it every now and then, but it's mostly retreating and catching goon balls. But the Zealot counts just decreasing for both players. But that's more of an army composition change, if anything. And there is the first Reaver from Bereaver. Do we have any such units? No, we have a Shuttle from Slater, interestingly enough. But we don't have a Reaver. Do we have a Reaver in production? Yes, we have a Reaver in production from Slater. And the first Reaver is out. It seems that Bereaver somehow pushing Slater back. Slither engaging favorably with the goons, like this retreat and firing logic cost Believer a lot of zealots, but Slither loses zealots as well. And now the tides are turning, Believer is here, and Believer is here with this caterpillar thingy, so as soon as a few river shots connect, it will be, the tide will be turned. And it is almost entirely goons now, although the army count is pretty much similar, some zealot reinforcements come in. And the Believer is just pushing this back. I'm gonna slow this down and see if they expand anywhere else. No, a lot of defensive cannons, and oh, that I like that Slater is attempting some shuttle river micro. Is it? Yeah, it is connecting, and you're not gonna defend with zealots if Slater knows what he's doing. So, counterintuitively, Slater is the one with the Shuttle River Micro, and yes, if you're a bot, you can do it with two rivers. Although, that river catches a shot, I don't know. Did it catch a shot, actually? I think it did. That river was full health. That shot was a dud. No, they didn't catch a shot. Nicely done. So they got picked up before the enemy river shot connected. And yeah, basically Slater is just sieging this base down with two river shuttle combos. And in the meantime, the assault is pretty much in the same place, tug of war in the middle of the map. But Slater has the advantage. This shuttle seemed a little bit over microed with this stuttering stuff. Oh yeah, and one shot gets eaten. It's a little bit too close for comfort, but yeah, if you drop down a river, you have 30 frames until it can fire, while the opposing river has no such limits. And yes, Slater is doing a little bit of damage here. Oh yeah, and the third base for Believer. Slater is doing a little bit of damage here, but actually, these river drops were not that effective. Still, this tug of war goes on, and it's a stalemate in the middle of the map. But Slater lost one river. What is happening here? I can't see because of this minimap. But actually, Believer with his own shuttle river combo just trying to do something, but the goons are here. I think a few probes got lost here because the probe count seems low, but I didn't catch that. And somehow Believer just got into the entrance. I think what probably happened is a few probes got busted down, and Believer just, or Slater just couldn't reinforce the army. And Slater has only three gateways, which making Protoss units is slow, so three gateways will not replenish the army that fast. And yeah, this is just a macro game at this point. 3 versus 2 bases, and I think a little bit, and looking at the worker numbers, Believer is clearly ahead, and we now see Templars, although those Templars don't really have energy. Do we have Storm? Yeah, we have Storm. No Templar energy researched, though. So, and the game just came to an end. I'm gonna call Believer as the winner here. Maybe Slater tapped out, it is unlikely, but that's the end of the game. Okay, let's... I'm gonna call it as Believer's win, although technically the game didn't end with that. And yeah, let's have the next one. And now we return to Heartbreak Ridge. It's Haupan versus Mad Mix Protoss. Mad Mix or Gathers is one of the bots that can play all three races, and it indeed does so, while Haupan is adamantly being Terran, and just rude, man. And but Haupan is the author, and the bot is actually called Halo. I should add that, but it is marked as Haupan on the SSCIT ladder, so let's just call it that every now and then. This is a failed attempt at a cannon rush, so that will not work. And Haupan losing some mining time, but generally not falling behind by that puny pylon attempt there. So, that being said, Mad Mix has no other pylons anywhere, so Mad Mix have to make a pylon if he wants to make anything. And is there a barracks already? No, there is no barracks. Oh, yeah, there is the barracks. And that is a tight gate that can be lifted. So, Open is good at turtling, sometimes not that good at taking bases at the right moment. That was my impression so far, but it is a formidable bot and should not be underestimated. Gateway coming out and a quick factory from Open. Maybe we will see a two factory even. Yes, that's surely a factory. No, that's a starport. Oh, that's interesting. I thought this will be a two factory build, but no. This is a starport. Barracks factory and starport. And what is that, sir? That is another command center. Yeah, just building a command center in your main and then floating it out. That is a thing that bots do recently. I remember it not being that much of a thing in the olden times. But yeah, it is fine. Oh, and I have a dropship. What is happening? I'm having trouble following the thought process here and just sneaking at the edge of the map, but I only saw one vulture loaded into that dropship. That does not mean that there aren't more, but it's interesting. Okay, let me slow this down. First of all, we see that the vulture micro is excellent, and yeah, one vulture can micro down infinite number of zealots, basically, and you can do it with multiple vultures in multiple positions, and let's see how this drop goes. It's probably, I'm betting that there is, no, there's a tank and two vultures. Okay, that works. And tank is quite a sturdy unit, and you need a lot of time to blast it down with just your probes. And yeah, this drop is just the death knell for Mad Mix. Right place, right time. Many probes being lost. I didn't even count, but Mad Mix has 5 probes left. Versus Hopen's 25, although there is a natural, so there is a theoretical chance free starting, but this tank is still in your base, and what will you do against this tank? Even if you get out a zealot, the vultures will just kill that. So this is very bad, and you need a cyber core, which you don't have. Yeah, this is just a matter of time. The two vultures and one tank is the composition that will defeat the entire Protoss army, which, to be fair, is entirely comprises of zealots. So that is a very nice drop from Haupen, just recognizing what needs to be done. There are a few cannons, but there are no workers left, so I'm gonna speed this up and call the GG at this point. Very nice. This sneaky edge of the map drop is surprisingly effective and well, what can I say, effective and a good strategy. So without further ado, let's jump into the next game. We didn't have a TVT just yet, so let's have a TVT. It's Dragon versus Red Ram. Dragon is a bot by TSC Moo, and it is based on a Cherry Pie, the Facebook's AI project, StarCraft AI project, which is sadly not updated for a while, and I hope that the Facebook AI team will decide to do that eventually, but let's focus on Dragon right here. It is a funny Terran bot. I like how it plays, and versus Redram, who I Redram is actually the red, which I don't know much about, but I think it is a formidable bot. Yeah, not even though it's not a high ranking one. So yeah, in this case I will quickly check out the rankings here and Redram's place in it. Yeah, it's actually not a high ranking, but I was mistaken. It's somewhere in the middle of the pack. Still, it can produce interesting games, and a quick expansion at the natural by Red Ram. Dragon is... I thought that was a building, that's weird. Dragon is not expanding. Oh, Dragon is expanding, never mind. As if these bots know what I'm gonna say and do the opposite. Some marines try to hunt down the scouting SCV, but not before it gets all the data it needs to. One defensive bunker from Dragon, and not much else from Red Ram. This building placement is probably just random, it feels like. It's just an algorithm, just go around and find the first spot. Quite a lot of supply for Red Ram. I don't know what's that about. Maybe it's just a preparation for something big. I don't know. It is weird. And two factories, and that will be probably an early two factory push. That suggests to me. But I don't know how you will get away with that, because we have a bunker here. Even though you need siege tanks, and for siege tanks you need machine shops, which you have none of. You are just building one. Vultures will not do much here because that is a bunker. Vultures do okay versus bio, but they don't necessarily do well against them, because the bio just can fire back, you know, then that's always detrimental, and bio can be healed very easily. And with M&M, Dragon is in a safe spot here, and Dragon is seem to be committed into a bio play, building the academy and more barracks here. Are these gonna be more barracks here? At least one of them, and the starport. Okay, what is actually Dragon doing? TSC Mu has been using Valkyries in the past. That is a thing that TSC Mu does. I'm not sure how well Dragon utilizes them, but I'm gonna go out on a limb and guess that Dragon thinks that Valkyrie good unit. So I don't know what else could be the starport. I mean, in TVT, what air units you really use? Wraith for harassment, maybe Valkyrie for anti-air, but I don't know. Okay, let's not speculate on that. Let's see what these bots will. Oh, that's a covert ops. Will we see nukes? Will we see nukes? That's not a physics lab. That's a covert ops. Or just ghosts. Or maybe we see lockdown. That is a possibility that we will see ghosts and lockdown. And indeed, a lot of ghosts are in production. Okay, this is gonna be interesting. What will those ghosts do? Because they, in a straight up fight, ghosts just suck against mech. That's not a surprise. Okay, what are you thinking, Dragon? What do we have? Lockdown. Yeah. So probably we see lockdowns. And the third base getting taken by Dragon. And yeah, this is the aforementioned trade where, yeah, bio can be microed down, but the Vulture is not escaping unscathed. So, yeah, in the TVT, Vulture harassment is a thing, but not as serious as in other matchups. Okay, so we have Steam and Lockdown. And we have four ghosts. We have eight ghosts now. Let's see. Oh, that siege tank's line is just so bad. I don't see the lockdowns being utilized, although maybe Dragon just wisely staying out of siege tank range. I mean, that is something I would do if I were a ghost or any kind of infantry unit. Tanks sieging up. Will we see a lockdown finally? Please, lockdown. And yes. One, oh well, locking down the same unit twice is not gonna earn you any good, and yeah, after lockdown you should move in, but nice attempt regardless. I think this lockdown will just time out. Okay, it's lockdown, bye. Oh no, they actually find it and maybe kill it. Oh, second lockdown, this is very nice to see. Third lockdown, oh, we have a vessel now. I guess Irradiate can be used against bio. Well, defensive matrix is maybe a more useful thing. Oh, another lockdown, nice. And I think that was an EMP. Do we have EMP? I don't see it, so... No, I thought... I think lockdown and EMP has very similar sounds, and that's why I thought it's an EMP. And yeah, that's another base from Red Ram. Red Ram actually has more bases, I think. It's 3 versus 1, 2, 3, 4, 4th being taken, and the main is still mining. This is getting really interesting. and the lockdown's making it work. Yeah, basically, Redrum does not have that many tanks, and you can just have more lockdowns than the enemy has tanks. And TSU is doing, well, excuse me, Dragon is doing exactly that. I don't think that locking down vultures is a good use of your energy, but hey, as long as it works. And maybe you should cloak your ghosts, because there is no detection and they can do that. And I think, oops, no, we don't have ghost cloak researched. That's interesting. Regardless, the bio army is defeating the mech army, which is not something you hear often. There is literally one tank, I stand corrected, zero tank, because all the others are locked down. And even though I think we have armor upgrades, no, we don't, we actually don't have armor upgrades, so... even with armor upgrades, these tank, without armor upgrades, these tanks are very durable against bio, especially that Dragon's infantry movement micro is not perfect. A lot of marines are falling behind and just not doing anything, but still, the same could be said for Redrum as well. Redrum's army movement is not 100% perfect either, so it balances out, and eventually, if you can't fire your tanks, that is detrimental to their performance, and yeah, that is what keeps happening. And vultures are not that durable either. They trade favorably against bio, but at some point there is this critical mass of bio ball when they lose a lot of effectiveness. And actually one lockdown times out just to have another one in its place, and these tanks just can't get a break. Yeah, these tanks just die. Although there is one in the high ground, that's gonna be hard to bust, but I'm speeding this up because the tide is just unstoppable. Another base taken by Dragon, base being taken by Dragon, and oh, in the meantime, dividing the army a little bit and killing the expansions as well. Just leaving two marines and two medics here. I really like that, because that's exactly the amount of force you need there. So the infantry is in Redrum's main. This can only go one way from here. I'm gonna speed it up and let it play out. This has been a beautiful bio usage by Dragon. A nice attempt from Redrum, but I think lockdown is not something you counter, because you just don't see it that often. So that was a very entertaining TVT, and let's see what's next. Meanwhile on Taukros, it's a ZVP match between Steaks Zerg, bought by Dennis Walther, aka Bitekeeper, I don't know which one of these two is his real name, and Tyr Protoss by Simon Prince. And what is, and I'm aware that I was showing Tyr and now I'm showing Stacks. And Tyr is an interesting bot, because the author actually participates in StarCraft 2 tournaments as well, and writes StarCraft 2 bots as well as World War bots, and congratulations to him. Tyr has been a good learning bot for many, because it's an open source Java bot, and I myself took a look on at its code when developing my own bot, so it is a good starting point. Maybe you shouldn't just outright fork it, but it is a good resource to have. Okay, let's see what these gentle bots are doing. A forge and a pylon. Why not block this entrance then? And those are surely cannons, yeah. A little bit strange placement for the cannons. If you expect Zerlings, you should have cannons probably. I mean, that's how it goes, but these cannons are quite approachable. Is that a cannon or a pylon? Oh, that's a cannon. So, I don't know, but at this point, Tyr has enough cannons, so that's fine, and just continuing on that path. But I don't know if the Zerglings can run by here. I think that there are maybe enough space for the Zerglings to run by. It is hard to judge sometimes, because clearly this field of view on this replay viewer is much more bigger than it is in the game. So hard to judge, but I would venture a guess and say that yes, they can run by here. But they can definitely run by, but I think they are slightly out of the range of these cannons. And we have Infinity Zergling streaming in. I don't know if Styx is tacking up or anything. No, just making another hatchery, not making many more workers. We have 7 workers, so I don't know. Is this like a 9 pool? And then building a hatchery and extractor? Could be. Let's call it a 9 pool for now. And I didn't watch closely, but we have a crap load of Zerglings, 37, and I think that is just too many Zerglings at this point, but we have one Zealot out. Well, I would bet on the Zerglings at this point, but they should attack at once, not one by one. Yeah, that's gonna be bad. I don't know what this shuffling around is about, but I think that can cost Styx the match. That can just easily cost Styx the match. And it's interesting because in human matches you see that kind of unit losses when the human player just can't pay enough attention at once everywhere. In both games, theoretically the attention of the bot is infinite, but we still see these stupid unit losses. They are just a result of a conscious decision, but that decision is probably very wrong. So it's interesting that how it compares and arrives at the same results, but for different reasons. And this is bot versus bot. And as someone who is a little bit into bot versus human play, I must say this is quite different than that. And more on that later. So, not much is happening. Let's speed this up because this is getting boring. And many more Zerglings will come here. Eventually, the Protoss army will just move out. This building placement seems kind of random here. And yeah, eventually the Protoss army moves out. And the Protoss army is just too much. And I think we have upgrades even. Yeah. Besides link speed, there is absolutely no upgrades for Styx. Some sunkens in the main just to hard the advance, but too little, too late. And that is a very clear win for T. And our last game today is Crazio Protoss versus Stone. Two wacky bots, Crazio Protoss being a cannon rush bot and Stone being a worker rush bot. Let's see which of these very silly strategies will win. I must say that Crazio's cannon rush strategy is surprisingly effective. And it's not just a cannon rush, it's cannon rush into DTs, into carriers or something like that. And I don't know if it received any serious updates recently. Stone didn't, I'm pretty sure of it. And Stone is just, the penultimate worker rush bot. Oh, so let's just reduce the sound a little bit. And yeah, indeed, the first workers are coming. Crazio is not really bothered by it, but there is no scouting probe, scouting slash cannon rushing probe from Crazio's side. And not much being done here. Worker rush, especially if done well by a bot, can be a surprisingly effective and devastating tactic. I myself lost to this bot once, but that was more of me not paying attention. But still, the SCVs do repair each other. So you can get caught by these very silly strategies. And I'm on the opinion that if it's stupid but works, it ain't stupid. So that is an interesting part, and I love to see this kind of shenanigans on the ladder. Actually, we have another worker rush bot on the ladder. It's called Purple Tickles, where the probes just tickle you to death. And it is by the author of Purple Wave, not very surprisingly. So we see this dance of probes and SCVs. The SCVs don't engage if there is a critical mass of opposing probes, and the probes basically do likewise. But Krizio is clearly ahead on mining because all the workers of stone are there. But the stone is, these are hard to count, but around 9 or 10 workers. So not that much ahead, or not that much behind, it depends on how you look at it. And stone does not have to spend any money on buildings because all it's making is acid. So, oh, what the hell? Stone is expanding to the other part of the map. Okay, I think this boat was made to annoy the enemy because you will find this base and then realize, wait, stone is still alive. That is very interesting, and Crazy is doing something here. Building, that's not where you should build a cannon. That's interesting, but there is a cannon there. And what else will happen here? Another pylon. But basically this dance continues and Stone is just not committing to an assault. Maybe Stone could have killed the gateway in the meantime. That would have been better. I don't know. It is really hard because worker rush is not a serious strategy that anyone employs, and it is really hard to say anything smart about it. Well, it's really hard to say anything smart about anything, but especially worker rush. And now we have a citadel. Is that Templar Archives? It could be a Templar Archives. No, that's Gateway. And the first dragoon is out. And actually, the dragoon is doing justice. Nice micro by Crazio. The workers actually try to engage the goon, and they manage to deal some damage, but a combat unit beats a worker for the most part. And indeed, this is what's happening. I love that Stone is repairing SCVs left and right, and goons don't deal as much damage to SCVs actually, they only deal 10, and that means that you need 6 shots to kill an SCV, and with this many SCVs around you can just out-repair that, although that is not what happening, not what's happening, but the DTs are out and there is no defense against the DTs. You can't out-repair that, the 2-shot SCVs, and eventually this base should be cleared up. But there is a lot of chasing around, but the worker count is... SCV count is visibly decreasing for Stone. Although Stone has how many bases now? 3, 4. What the hell? It's like a 5 base. Oh no, that's a 4 base, sorry. 4 base worker rush. What is even happening here? And the DT is actually having trouble keeping up with killing the workers. And it's so crazy. Apparently you can outproduce even a DT damage. And they don't really repair each other anymore because there is just no time. And the DTs just run around, try to get a shot in, because of course the SCVs just retreat and they are not that easy to get. I think the DTs are faster than the SCVs though, and they catch a lot of them, but where are the DTs though? Oh, there is one, there is another here somewhere, but where is the... I don't know, this game is getting really hard to keep track of. No DTs in any enemy base. Oh, there. Just as I said it, I spotted them. So, the enemy bases got found. Another base here, and taking the center. And this is just very silly because there are still a crap load of SCVs in your main base, and it's just crazy. It's not doing anything against them. Oh yeah, and cannons. Like one cannon here could have turned this around a long time ago. And now these SCVs find the cannons and suicide into them. Probes still do the dance, and that is very detrimental to Crazio's mining. It's taking even Crazio's natural, come on, that is just so I don't even, so contemptuous and like ungentlemanly from Stone. Stone is taking almost every base on the map now. I even trying to take this base at Crazio's main island. Crazio was in trouble because he's stacking up, but I don't see any carriers just yet because there is literally no gas mining going on. Oh, there is one probe mining gas, and the production tab is just SCVs and supply depots. We have 135 SCVs. Come on, this is just ridiculous. Just plop down one or two cannons here. That's all you need to do. Oh, there is one cannon a little bit closer, but at this point the SCVs can't just win. I think this is a very real possibility that Stone will just ram in and win. Maybe Crazy will get out a carrier, I don't know. At this point anything goes, really. It's like... I can't even describe this game. These probes are having trouble mining, and I think we don't have enough gas for one carrier, and that is our big problem. So eventually maybe Crazy will get enough gas for literally one carrier, but no, Crazy is not mining. Crazy is not mining anything, which eventually will lead to its downfall because Crazy is losing workers. Well, lost a few, I must say, and it's crazy because Stone is maxing out. Stone is close to maxing out, like 150. Wait, what is the supply for Stone that is not SCVs? We have a supply and supply count and worker count are different. Why? I don't really understand this. This is so many, and imagine what a few reavers could do here. This is so many, and eventually, like, I don't know how this will end. I really have no idea. Now we have this great worker mosh pit here. I can't even know how to describe this. Crazio is not mining, Crazio is not making an army. We have been on 74 gas for a long time now, and eventually maybe we get enough gas for one silly, stupid carrier, and then Crazio can mop up the map. I don't know where are the DTs, because the DTs should, like, the DTs are actively killing, there you go, the DTs are actively killing SCVs, but there are too many. They are multiplying by a frightening factor, and we are producing another DT. Oh, I really expected carriers here. I really thought that the DVSC carrier, but some workers come into these two cannons, and that's basically it for them. This is just a weird, weird, weird stalemate where all the bases are getting, except for the island bases, all bases are getting taken by Stone, and I don't even, I literally can't even right now. And the SCVs are very, very slowly but making way, and it's like 150 SCVs, and KZO can't keep the SCV numbers down. It's like 5 DTs or even 6 DTs, like massacring them, but they still can't keep the SCV count down. I mean, it has to be mined out at some point in this map, and finally the first carrier is out, and that will turn the tide for sure. And mostly just by enabling these poor workers to finally mine something, because these workers were defending Crazio's base. It's crazy. Let's see, okay, a carrier is out, we need interceptors of course, but minerals we have enough, that's okay. I wonder when will this carrier move out, because there is literally no defense against the carrier. The DTs, well, there is no defense against the DTs either, but they are a little bit easier to avoid. And clearly, six DTs versus the entire map. Is just the entire map just outproduces the DTs. And finally the carrier clearing up a little, but Crazio is not out of this yet. Crazio not out of the woods, although a lot of damage is being done. And oh, a zealot. How did we get a zealot? Maybe that is what we should have had. Oh no, the zealot dies. So we have almost maxed 180 SCVs, but the carrier is doing a lot of damage. And it's just stupid. And finally getting cornered by the carrier and the DTs. Slowly but surely the SCV count seems to be dropping. And yeah, it's slowly. And these four cannons, these should have been placed here earlier. The SCVs don't really know what to do here. I guess eventually more carriers will come, and finally Crazio can mine. This is the big thing here, because Crazio was denied from actually mining minerals and gas, and that is the thing, that the workers were pulled back to defend, which is a good move by itself. Oh, these four cannons deal so much damage. And remember, I'm playing it at 2 or 4 times speed, and this game has been going on in real time for 36 minutes. I mean, this is the type of game that you can only see in bot versus bot games, and it is just beautiful and an excellent closing game for this broadcast. And before I forget, please check out schnail.com, that schnail.com, where you can download the Schnail client. Schnail stands for StarCraft Human and AI League, and play against most of these bots that you saw here. I think all of these bots are available on the Schnail ladder as well, and you as a human player can test yourself against them. There is no install there is install needed, but there is no configuration needed. You just install it and go. So if you think you can beat the top bots, this is your chance to prove it. And it is just a fun thing to do. So that is a platform that I created, and I really hope that you will enjoy it. Okay, let's get back to the game as it enters its closing phase. Literally every base except the island base is taken by stone. Let's speed this up. The worker count is now really decreasing, because we have 6 carriers on the map just mopping up everything, and finally the command centers are getting mopped up, and maybe the mining SCVs as well. So stone's income actually suffers, and this is the thing that was undisturbed for most of the game. Stone could just mine as much as he wanted, and yeah, this is getting to a close. The carriers dealing so much damage, but there are so many command centers, and that's just so much to mop up. It takes literally like 10 minutes or 50 minutes even up on a post. I think Stone just taps out at this point. This has been an amazing game, and see you next week when Nightcat will cast the games.